The following program is sponsored by Reed Migraine Centers and features medical questions from viewers. Nothing within the program establishes doctor-patient confidentiality.
Hello and welcome to Ask the Doctor. I'm your host, Mike Berger. Joining us today is Dr. Kenneth Reed from Reed Migraine Centers to discuss a revolutionary procedure used to alleviate migraines. Dr. Reed is the founder of the revolutionary Reed procedure, used specifically for treatment of chronic severe headaches. There will also be taking your calls and email questions. The number is 1-855-5-MIGRAINE or log on to the website at www.reedmigraine.com. Dr. Reed, thanks for being here. Tell us a little bit about the neurostimulation and the Reed migraine. This is really fascinating. I know people that have had migraines. Most of our viewers know those people. And this sounds pretty impressive.
Well, I think it is. For patients that respond to this, it can be dramatic. It can change their life. Neurostimulation has actually been used for quite a while for pain in the neck and back, called a spinal cord stimulator. These have been implanted around the world. Numerous specialists in the DFW area have been doing it since the 1960s. Hundreds of thousands of patients for chronic neck and back pain. What we did is use the same technology but applied it for headaches. Initially in the back of the head in 1990s, where we had a series of patients, we reported in the medical literature excellent results. It's called occipital nerve stimulation. That procedure is actually done around the world now for pain in the back of the head. Well, we found it didn't work as well for migraine headaches, more commonly pain in the front and side of the head. So about 6 years ago, we extended this technique, added in a frontal component, and now I've seen an excellent response rate with, indeed, dramatic responses with most of our patients for this.
That sounds fabulous. Can you tell us a little bit about the microstimulator and actually how it works? Is that like a little battery somewhere that...
Well, exactly so. I think we have a graphic, if we can put it up. A neurostimulator, the device, and it's made by three large companies in the United States, all excellent equipment. It consists of a small battery. It's very similar to a pacemaker battery. In fact, the companies make these, and three long wires, plastic-covered wires. The battery is actually typically implanted in the upper outer hip, and there's reasons for that. Then it's very simple to pass these little wires up under the skin. Two of them end up in the back of the head, right under the skin, over what we call the occipital nerves, and two pass over to the front, just right in the eyebrows. You cannot see it. There's no scars. You can't even tell it's there. It's actually a very safe procedure. When it's turned on, the patient will feel just a mild tingling sensation. It tends to feel very good, and by certain mechanisms, that will often dramatically ease the patient's pain.
I have to ask you, and I'm thinking about football players, anybody that plays sports, any chance that these wires would break or?
Well, another good question. We implant these in a lot of athletes. We have 30 teenagers so far, cheerleaders, gymnasts, water skiers, snow skiers, baseball player. Haven't had a football player yet, but we can absolutely put them in football players. There's no restrictions. It's very safe. Now, it is medical equipment. It could move or something,
sure.
But even then it's very safe, and we can replace it back there. But it's been very successful in our very active young patients.
How many types of neurostimulators are being used?
If you look on the internet, there's actually a lot of types and can be easily confused. For our purposes, we describe four different main types of neurostimulators. The most common one is what I mentioned earlier. It's been used around the world for neck and back pain, and that's called a spinal cord stimulator. By the way, the equipment is the same for them all, a little battery and these wires. The battery in the hip for spinal cord stimulation, it passes the neck and back. Tingles will ease neck and back pain.
So it sounds to me like what you're saying is we're actually stimulating nerves.
That's exactly what we're stimulating. Under the skin, from the front of the head, it's called a supraorbital stimulator, the back occipital. That's what we term a Reed procedure. What it's doing is stimulating these very superficial nerves, not the brain, just right under the skin, the nerves. The patient feels a very mild tingling sensation. But by certain mechanisms, it looks like it's actually not covering up the pain, but actually working deep in the brain to actually stop the headaches from occurring in the first place.
And of course, once these are implanted, You can't see them. No one else can see them.
It's very interesting. Completely under the skin. There's no scars visible. There's no lumps. We patients go out in swimsuits. Nobody can tell that they have them in. There's no restrictions. The patient can't feel it. Patients tend to get along with these quite well.
Now, you mentioned the Reed procedure, and you actually started doing this with migraine headaches some time ago. But the Reed procedure is a little addition to what a lot of people were doing.
Exactly so. It's what we term, the technical name for it is combined occipital nerve, supraorbital nerve stimulator. We were the first to apply them in the back of the head, occipital nerve stimulator, in the 1990s. That's used around the world now. But about 6 years ago, we added in the two leads in the front, that combined system we call the Reed procedure for migraine headaches, and that's the one we're using in most cases now.
All right, the phone lines are open, and we want to get started, so let's go right to Robin from Addison. Robin, what's your question?
The neurostimulator, it sounds so like futuristic Star Trek kind of, you know? Will there be a time when migraines will just be like history?
It's a great question. I think the way to look at this is this tends to be an extremely good, often dramatic, life-changing treatment for patients that respond. But I'd emphasize, it's not a cure. The headaches are not gone. They're there. This is stopping them. I think it's, you know, probably the next best thing. So like a lot of things in medicine, we can treat it. In this case, I think very effectively, but like high blood pressure, heart disease, it's not a cure. It's an excellent treatment for it.
We really don't know what causes migraines, do we?
We don't know the full mechanisms. As in a lot of things, there's a lot of excellent research being done. International research, there's several medical journals that this is published in several times a year. Our research has been published in those. By the way, it's easily accessible on the internet. The research is down to fine neurochemical mechanisms, neurophysiology of the brain. We have excellent imaging studies, so we have a lot of information on how migraines work and what start, but still not the final answer.
Yeah, so one of these days, we might come up with that answer.
Absolutely. That's the goal. That's okay. The holy grail.
We're going to take a short break. We'll be right back. This is an interesting show. Stay with us.